why there's so many methods to signal. Why? Because there's so many methods to signal. I'm keeping this real basic this morning because I see everyone just had breakfast. You're fat, you're happy, you're tired. Some of you want to go back to bed, I know that. Let's talk about some of the ways we can signal for help. Any ideas?
Yeah. Sat phone.
There we go. A verbal signal. Help.
Whistle.
Whistle. What type of signal would that be?
Audio.
Just like help.
Mirrors.
Mirrors.
Flashlight. Flares.
Flashlight flares.
Smoke.
Fire.
Fire.
Signs.
Huh?
Signs. Making a sign.
Making a sign. There we go. I don't know how they do it. I don't know.
This parachute right here.
Oh, sorry.
John, this parachute right here makes a great signal.
That, absolutely it does. Okay, let's talk about fire first. In a survival situation, one thing we know we always got to have is fire. Fire. We got to stay warm. I wasn't at the fire class yesterday, but you know there's just tons of reasons to have a fire in a survival situation. It provides us so many things. Well, one thing it does provide us is the capability to signal. What part of fire might we use to signal?
The hot part.
Smoke.
The most visible fire.
Smoke. The most visible fire. There we go. That's a response I haven't heard yet. There's two aspects. One would be the brightness of the flame. When would we use that?
Night.
What's the other aspect?
The smoke.
Okay, I want you all to maintain the class. I notice we're gonna do a little exercise here in a little while because I like to get you all out of the class. And I always notice that when we do an exercise, when I come back, we got like half a class. Okay? If you're going to leave halfway through the class, make sure you come back at the end of the class because we're going to have some real fun at the end. That's just a little teaser. They call that this thing they use in Visio, a teaser. Although there's some other terms that teasing can be used also, and we'll get into that here. Okay, fire. You want to have a lot of smoke. Well, during the day, you want smoke that's going to be seen at a long distance. So you want a lot of smoke and you want dark smoke. Okay, depending on the background. At night, you're going to want flame. One of the things we're going to learn in signaling is there's international signaling, which is just known internationally, and that's the groups of three. So when we get into audio, it's going to be three, and it's going to be the same way with fire. If you're just by yourself, and no one is expecting you to be back at a certain time, and you're just out there, to having one fire might work to call in rescue. The problem with that is they may also think you're just a guy out there camping and have a fire. So everything we do in signaling, keep in mind that we want groups of three. So if we're going to have fire, get three. They can be in a straight line. They can be in a three in a triangle. But that's an international distress. You'll find when we get into audio, you want to do everything three times.
It's like the same with gunshots where they do three shots in the air.
There'd be space.
Excuse me?
If you had like three fire signal fires for smoke, how widely apart should they be?
How widely apart? That's a good question. I don't have the exact answer because I've never
wide enough to be seen.
What I would say is that you would want them far enough apart to be able to distinguish that there's three.
There you go.
Does that make sense? So if you put three right close together from the air, I mean, it could appear as one large fire or one large smoke column. If I was going to use smoke generators, I would probably put them about 10 feet apart. So from the air, there'd be three columns of smoke. That answer your question? Answer was
it would depend on the situation, but yeah.
It would depend on the situation where you are. But if you get them too close together, once all the smoke starts coming up, it's going to look like one column
of
smoke.
That's what I'd be afraid of.
That's what I'd be afraid of. Someone else put a hand up?
We kind of messed around with that a little bit, you know, distances in between that. And we found that you know, the wider you put them away from each other, the bigger it looks and the easier it is to see from a distance because obviously it's wider and bigger. But the problem with getting too wide is you got to be able to tend and get these signal fires lit. So you got to find the medium between big enough to see and close enough
to get them going.
You know, you might have mere seconds to get your signal fires lit when the search plane's coming, and if you got them 100 yards apart, yeah, it ain't going to happen.
Did you find a distance to kind of work?
It all depends on, you know, I might be able to move a little faster than you, or you might be able to get them lit a little faster than me, so I mean, it all varies.
It also depends on your terrain.
It depends on terrain.
125-foot conifers in a closely spaced. You got an issue with the fire.
Right, well, you want to get them out in the clear space, yeah, if you can find it. Everything was signaling. We want to get out in the open. You don't want to start three fires inside, like our training camp where we run our school is called Cedar Grove, because we built it in the middle of a cedar grove. Well, you start three fires in there, nobody's going to see it from the air. The smoke's going to filter up through all the trees. It's just going to look like we're on fire. So whenever possible, try to get in a clear area, and that's one thing we learn when you're picking a place to camp for tonight or a place to stay for tonight, is be clear enough, close enough to be able to get wood, get stuff for fire, build a shelter, but be close enough to an area where you can set up your signaling and be able to go out and do it. Another thing with these smoke and these type of signals when you're out there is what you have to keep in mind is ambient conditions, okay? It could be raining. It could be an overcast day. It could be real windy. The problem we've seen with real, real windy days, and for everybody that's been here, you'll see sometimes it's just calm as hell. And then when the chopper comes over, this wind is going to pick up, and it's going to blow all the smoke horizontal. It's not going to go up vertical. So these are things you're going to have to keep in mind when you're working on a fire for signaling. Obviously, you've got to hope for the best. But if it's a real rainy day, you may need another signaling technique. And that's why we're going through so many today, so that you have multiple options to use while you're out there. Audio. Someone mentioned audio, and I believe it was Paul. One of the best audio signals out there is a whistle. Everybody here should carry a whistle. If you have children, every child should carry a whistle. This is just something that you can blow all day. You can get out there and you can yell and you can scream and you call for help, and you're going to eventually lose your voice. As we've seen here, Alan has been yelling while he's been here, and Alan has basically lost his voice. Okay, so, but a whistle, how many times would we blow on a whistle?
Three.
Three times. Okay, you're a real intelligent group we have here. Three times. So what do you all got to do is toot, toot, toot. Wait a while, toot, toot, toot. I mean, you could do that for weeks. Of course, if you ain't found in weeks, you got a lot more trouble than your voice. But you can do this forever. The thing what I find with whistles is there's tons of them out there. There's tons. And most people really never look at signal whistles, determine what's the best, what's the worst. And they don't test things like I do. I like to play with everything and test it and see if it works. P whistles. There's a lot of whistles out there with a P in them. Okay, I don't like those for signaling. If you lose the P, it's like your GPS, your batteries go dead. It's useless to you. So try to get a P-less whistle, except for two. And that's because we'll be showing those here in a moment. And these are whistles that are internally contained in a chamber where they can't be lost. Okay? And they're the only two P whistles I recommend. The other thing is metal whistles. I see a lot of people like these little metal whistles. You don't want to carry a metal whistle, especially if you're in a winter environment, because they will freeze to your lips. Okay? So always try to carry plastic if you got it. We're going to do a little test of whistles here, because I want you to get an idea of what type of whistles there are. This is just some of the whistles I've tested. And these go from what I call good, the best, down to less best. There's none here that are bad. No whistle is bad.
So good, better, best?
Excuse me?
Good, better, best?
No, not good, better, best. They're just as far as I call it, the best. But the thing is, what you're going to find out with these, I'm going to have Alan go out and he's going to blow these. As I explain to you the whistle, he's going to go blow this thing, and we're going to be able to hear from a distance what they sound like. What you have to remember is we all have different ears. Dogs can hear a dog whistle. We can. Some of that are the extremely loudest on here, you're all going to hear real well. But as we get down into multi-tone and triple-tone whistles, there's a lower, flatter sound. There's one on here that my students at our last class, or the last thing we just did in Ohio, that students could hear the whistle and I couldn't hear it. Now, part of that is the fact that I'm an Ofark. Okay, so there's tones now that I can't hear that I used to hear. So keep this in mind that there's a lot of different sounds out there that other people are going to be able to hear. The advantage of this is some of these whistles can be heard up to 3-4 miles. You yell, and I don't think there's anybody in here, including myself, who can yell up to 3-4 miles. So always carry a whistle with you, especially children. Children carry a whistle. That way, if they're lost, tell them, blow the whistle. Okay, the first one I'm going to discuss here, this is allegedly, and I haven't found anyone to be able to prove it isn't, this is the loudest whistle made. It's called the storm whistle. It's American made. It has a P in it, but it's in an internal chamber. And the internal chamber allows us to purge water. This blows underwater up to 50 feet.
Wow.
You can hear it up to 50 feet underwater. This is used by the U.S. military. It is said to be able to be heard over the rotors of the helicopter.
When that's blown under the water, can you hear it when you're out of the water? Or only if you're in the water as well?
If you're in the water. Yeah. So I'm going to try to find Alan. Alan is out there somewhere.
It's called the storm whistle.
This is called the storm whistle. Alan, you out there?
I am.
Where are you?
Just smack in. Put your hands down. I got to go.
Okay, he is the back side of the circle over there. The circle where we are. Blow number one for me, would you?
Wow.
That's pretty good.
That's the one you have in your hand right now?
That's this one right here.
Wow.
The next one is made by the same company. It's called the Windstorm. Almost as loud. They made it differently. You can see this is not only the loudest whistle out there, it's the largest. Okay? This is one that I particularly probably would not carry only because of its size. Okay? And as you all know, I play with survival kits a little bit, and I want to make sure it's in the survival kit. This is made by the same company. It's called the Windstorm, and they made it smaller. It's got the same P in there in an internal chamber. It purges itself underwater, can be heard underwater, and it's, in my opinion, just about as loud. Alan, blow two.
Yeah, that's pretty close.
Pretty
yeah.
loud.
What's the P in it? You mentioned the winter, the metal whistles in the winter not being a choice. Can't those please?
They've never had a problem with it. I asked them that, and they said because it's plastic on plastic. Now, one thing you want to keep in mind, if you blow it long enough, you're going to get condensation and you're going to get moisture. But they've never had a problem with the plastic freezing to the plastic.
Okay.
The next one is the Fox 40. This has been one of my favorite for years. It started out as a referee whistle and quickly became one of the most used survival whistles out there. This is a very loud whistle. It can be heard for a very long distance, and the tone of it happens to be one that I like. As you can see, it's shaped like a whistle. Part of that is a design effect, and it has been designed so that it looks like a whistle. One of the first things I did, because I wanted to carry this particular whistle all the time on my little survival thing, was I found out on the bottom here, it's fake. It's just to make it look like a whistle. See, you can trim these down to a very small size. It takes nothing from the sound. It doesn't create any difference, any lower sign, but it makes it a lot more flatter thing to be able to carry on your key ring. Let's see what that sounds like. Alan, would you blow three, please? Here it's a different sound. Did everyone hear that?
Very unique.
It's a unique sound, which I happen to like. A while later, they decided to redesign the Fox 40 and come up with the Fox 40 Micro. Same company. From here on, from the Fox 40 on, these are all P-less whistles. This whistle is made by the same company. What they did was they made it flatter. Okay, it's a flatter, so you can fit it in a survival kit. This sets in. This is Fox 40 Micro. Alan, number four, please. Once more, Alan. Everyone hear that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I barely heard that. Number five. This is an ACR whistle. This is made, you can see, very flat. And where they get the size and the shape of these is that people want to be able to carry them in a small package and a survival kit. Everything in life is a trade-off, people. You're going to find when you go from size to smaller size, you're obviously going to lose sound. But it's something is better than nothing. Alan, blow five, please.
Whoa.
Different tone. A total different tone. You'll see there's two slots in here. Can everyone see this?
Dual
there's
tone.
Two slots. So it's a dual tone. That's what it means by dual tone. I find when it's dual tone, it gets flatter. Let's just do a quick thing on audio. I'm not an expert on audio, but I know there's high frequency, there's low frequency. As you get to a higher frequency, it becomes much more directional. To prove that to you, so you understand what I'm talking about without getting into a real electronics course here, is when you get up into microwave, you get up into some of the lot higher frequencies, you will find directional antennas on these towers, or there will be parabolic type of the antennas. What that is the higher the frequency goes, the much more directional it is. As the frequency comes down lower, which is where we're going now, we're going to lower frequencies, but it becomes more omnidirectional, which means it goes everywhere. So even though the tone of some of these whistles may be lower now, they're becoming more omnidirectional. If you've got a real directional or a high frequency whistle, you really want to be blowing it like this, so that it's going out. As with all whistles, obviously the wind is going to transfer it. But the lower the frequency, it may sound less loud, but you're getting more of the directional sound on it. This one is called the marine whistle. This was made to carry on a personal flotation device. If you carry it, if you wear a PFD and a canoe, you're boating, something like that, it has a large clip on it so you can carry it on you. As you can see, this is also a dual tone whistle. Okay, it's got the two chambers in it. Alan, would you please blow number six?
Very maritime.
That's a little bit louder. Blow that one more time, Alan. See, it's not that loud, crisp, but it's omnidirectional. Mm-hmm. It's a lower tone. It's what we call a flatter tone. Okay, this here is called a cylinder whistle. Very small little cylinder whistle. Looks like some of the ones they use for dog whistles. This is made of just a little piece of aluminum. It's got a plastic insert into it. And this is very easy to carry on a key ring, carry in a survival kit, carry on your neck. Alan, would you blow number seven, please? Everyone hear that?
Yeah.
Not real loud, but something is better than nothing. Now we've gotten into, this is made by Topps Knives. Actually, it's not made by Topps Knives. It's made by a company who makes it for Topps Knives, but it has their name on it. This is called a triple tone whistle. You all start seeing it has three slots into it. And this gives even a lower, flatter tone for a whistle. To me, this one I have very difficult hearing, but some of my other people who listen to this say this thing is great, so let's see. Alan, would you blow number eight, please?
Wow.
Did he blow it?
Yeah.
You shouldn't, right? Alan, would you blow that one more time?
There's a high frequency touch to it.
I didn't hear it.
Some people probably can't hear.
All right, I'm old. What can I say? Thank you, Alan. Go take a break. Brush your teeth. We'll see you in a couple of days.
Dumb as you were.
Wash them. As you were. The last time last class we did, I had him blow number nine, waited, and he said, I didn't know what to do. You only had eight. You know? Anyway, no brain science here.
What were the names of number five, seven,
number
eight?
Five.
Try to follow along, Adam.
ACR whistle. Here is a list up here. I got a couple of laminated sheets. Anyone after class want to know what these are? I'm going to leave the ring sitting here, and these little cards here tell you exactly what the whistle is in the event you're interested. If one particularly hits your fancy, then please come up and get the name of it and get one of those for your survival kit. Whistles. There are a lot of ways to make a whistle out in the field. We used to do the tin whistle. I think someone was doing one here earlier this week. Al Cornell
was making one.
Who?
Al Cornell.
Al Cornell was making one. And we learned that in Boy Scouts back in 1832 or whenever it was I was in there. And back then, we actually had tin cans. I mean, when we made them, that now you buy, you get these cans and it's like a little piece of nothing, but they still, at our school, we still have the students make a whistle out of one. We obviously don't have time in a one-hour class, but we teach you how to cut it up and make a whistle, and basically what you're doing is using your fingers as the side of the whistle to close the side in, and they're rather effective. Of course, any whistle is better than none. Another thing you can do is use acorn tops or bottle caps for a soda bottle. Okay. Anyone got a soda bottle here that has a cap on it? A scoop cap?
Or a beer bottle.
Where's my... Denise, she's much better at this than me. Yeah, could I have the top? An acorn you would use the same way. What you're going to do with this cap is you're going to put your thumbs over it in a manner whereby you enclose the whole top, but you leave a little V where the ends of your thumb are, and then you're going to blow it across your thumbs. And this is going to be used as a whistle. Anything that's concave, the best we have found out there is acorns. Okay? But you'd be amazed at where you'll go where there has been no human being ever, and you will find water bottles. They're prehistoric water bottles, but they got these plastic caps. Try that, would you, darling?
Yeah, no guarantees here. This is
no, it's pretty small.
Uh-huh. Does that work with this?
Got a better one?
Yeah, I got a big one over here, baby.
Oh, here. All right.
I got one right here.
I'll
replace it later.
Saving plastic, environmentally friendly.
I got one, John.
All right.
My survival.
Make me run around like an asshole.
Oh, yeah, okay. Why are you letting me do it, man? All right, there you go. More than I do.
Anyway, a bottle cap. That was great. Let's have a hand for Denise and for Peter.
Even these will work.
This is a cap from a beer.
Not that there's beer involved anyway, right?
Oh, that's
wow.
As you can see, people, not as effective as a real whistle, but if you work with these, you can get them working. They are something better than nothing, and you can blow on this all day as opposed to yelling. And what you want to do is make noise. It beats building an Indian drum while you're out there, because that's very time consuming. Okay, so think about that as an audio whistle. Okay, one of the most underrated signaling devices out there is a signal mirror. What do we do with a signal mirror?
You can flash helicopters.
You can flash helicopters. Can't you pretty much flash anything?
Yeah.
If we know there's a rescue team up on this hill here coming down in this valley, we can flash them up there and let them know where we are.
As long as there's light.
Don't blow my head.
Flashing in the dark.
We could be up on the hill there and we could see the rescue team coming up. Couldn't we signal down? Okay. One of the things you obviously need with a signal mirror...
light.
Sun. Okay. There's a lot of different signal mirrors out there. A lot. Now, I'm going to show you what I consider to be probably the four best. There are different ways to use a signal mirror. Signal mirrors normally have a hole in the middle. It's called a sighting hole. There are two types of signal mirrors. Those with just a sighting hole, and then those with a retroreflective grid. Okay? Now, I don't want to get into real technicalities here, but let me give you a brief idea of what a retroreflective grid is. My teeth are moving. Okay, there we go. A retroreflective grid, when you look at the mirror, and you're all going to go out here and play with these in about 5 minutes, it's a grid that has, it looks like a little screen, like on your screened-in porch or something like that. It's a little screen. Where that screen is coated with retroreflective material. This was invented by a guy for the military. And what this retroreflective stuff is on there is it's made from the same material and was invented by 3M. and it's used on road signs. You will notice when you're driving down the road at night and your lights hit a road sign, when you come straight on it, the light comes right back at you. Okay? That's the magic of the retroreflective grid. Now, if they just put a flat thing on there, like a road sign, then you couldn't see through it. So they take this chemical stuff and they mount it to this screen, and then they put it in the circle. Now, the advantage of this is when the sun comes in to the screen, it bounces back in the same angle, but miraculously, and that's the part I don't know because I'm not an engineer, it causes a little round burst of light on that screen. And amazingly, when you put this up to your eye and you get the sun to hit the screen, you will see a little burst of light. And wherever you move that burst of light, that signal mirror is pointing directly at that. So when you move that little burst towards a chopper or towards something that you want to signal to, you are directly pointing at that. All you have to do at that point is just tilt the mirror back and forth a little bit, and you are causing a flash directly at them. Okay? This is a good thing. This was a great invention. Everyone has their own opinions of everything. Myself, being an old-fashioned, practical type of survival guy, what I don't like about it, not only the fact that I'm old, but I really like to use my peripheral vision. Okay? Especially when you're out in the woods, you never know where these people are. So what you may want to do is be looking for the chopper. You know where the sun is, you know where your mirror is, but you're looking for the rescue thing. And when I got something held up to my face, it blocks one side of my peripheral vision. I'm looking through this little hole. So what I like to use is the old-fashioned method, and that is when you take a mirror, what you're going to do is you're going to put two fingers up like this or like this, however you want to do it, and you're going to take the mirror, and we're going to all go out and do this so you see exactly what I'm talking about. You're going to put a flash of light on both of these fingers. Okay? Once you get that flash of light on your fingers, where do you think the flash is going? Directly between your fingers. So all we have to do, and it sounds real hard, and you're going to find out it really isn't, but it's something you have to do once before you need it, so you know you can do it. You got to direct the sunlight to the mirror, and then the light from the mirror between your fingers. And you have to move these until you get the target, the chopper, or wherever you're trying to signal, between your fingers. When you can see the light hit both fingers, you know it's going through. You're directing that light directly on the target. Why I like this method is I have peripheral vision both sides. I can see what I'm doing. I can hear the noise over here. I can move around, and I can direct the light towards the target without having one side of my face covered. Does that make sense to you? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Whatever you like, you will do. I think the four best mirrors out there, this is the Vector Survival Mirror or Signaling Mirror. It's a 3-inch by 5-inch. It's laminated glass both sides. This is the best. One of the things you have to understand with this, it is laminated glass. This is solid glass. Okay? So this can be broken in a survival situation. A company called Survival Resources had padded cases made up for these. So if you get these, they go in here and they keep them from breaking. This does have the retroreflective grid in it. So this is a retroreflective grid. You don't have to use the grid. You can use it, or you can signal like this. One of the things I left out in retroreflective grid, you need the proper angularity in order to be able to get the burst to the target. So there are often times where even if you have a retroreflective grid, the angularity between the sun and the target is not there, so you still have to go back to the fingers anyway. So I want you all to be able to do this with your fingers or be able to look through the grid. This is the Vector 1 2x3. Same company. These have been used by the Air Force for years and years and years and years. Difference, obviously, is size. This is the one that lives on each of my packs. There is a pouch on each of my packs that carries this mirror and my mirror compass. It's always on the left side of all my pack straps.
I'm sorry, what was the smaller one called?
Excuse me?
What was the smaller one called?
It's the Vector
2x1.
2x3 signal mirror. This is called the Vector 1. Now, years ago, one of my favorite mirrors was called the Star Flash Mirror. It was made by Survival Incorporated. And it was encased in Lexon, and it floated. It did a lot of things. It wasn't actually glass, but it was a really decent mirror. It didn't have a retroreflective grid, but then I don't often use them. And they discontinued it. Vector One, who makes these two mirrors, come out with a signal mirror that is almost identical to that. It's encased in Lexon. It floats. You can't scratch it. And this is actually glass in here. They have this glass made in Japan. It is a very thin piece of glass mirror. It's an actual glass mirror, so that it's not plastic, it's not mylar, it's not a shiny material, it's actually glass. This thing is very light, you're gonna see. This thing weighs next to nothing. And this is a very good mirror for a survival kit, and if you're concerned with something breaking, this is a very good mirror to have.
And it's called one more time?
Excuse me?
What is it called one more
Vector
time?
Vector One.
That's Vector One.
Vector number one. Just Ergle. The number one. This is a rescue flash. This is made by Adventure Medical Kits. Again, it has the retroreflective grid in it. How many people are manufacturing this retroreflective grid? One. Vector. Okay. So Adventure Medical Kits went to Vector One and said, we would like to buy that technology from you so that we can use it, because we basically want to copy your mirror, make it a little thinner and do that. And my friend said, I don't think that's going to happen, but I'll tell you what I'll do is I'll sell you the retroreflective grid for your mirror. So the grid in this mirror is the same that's in those three. Okay, look at the thickness of this. So this is a nice type of mirror. If someone was going to be crazy enough to like build a survival kit in an Altoids tin, this might be the type of mirror that you would want to put in that. It's very thin, very light, has the retroreflective grid. What I want to do is I got two of each of these. I want to get everybody out in this back field here. I want you to line up. I want you to come up. And I want you to actually do this. I want you to be able to get the burst on your finger and be able to see this. What we're going to do is me and Denise, and we're all going to stand out there, and you can try to flash on us to get a flash on it. This is not difficult, but if you've never done it, you may feel a little retarded when you first start it. Okay, but within two or three, once you get it, you're going to go, this isn't hard at all. But now when you need that skill for a survival situation to signal, you're not out there going, oh, I've never done this before. That way, everyone in this class, at least I know, when you go to signal with the mirror that you're going to buy after this class, obviously, you're going to run home and order one of these, then you're going to at least be able to use it effectively to help yourself for self-rescue. So come on up here, grab a mirror. Is anyone talking to me?
Yeah.
Alright.
No.
I know you all hate watching me in the morning. I mean, I'm ugly as sin when I get up. But okay, very easy, people. See these two fingers? Watch this. Here's my signal mirror. See the square on my fingers?
Yeah.
Wherever I move this, do you see that on the ground? Where's Ryan? Run over there, Ryan. Or you can be. Turn your back to me so I don't get you in there. See the back of Denise?
Yeah.
Do I?
Oh, baby. Looks like a light show. Oh, look at it. See, right, they're having a ball. Okay, retroreflective grid, what you're going to do. All of these mirrors are retroreflective grid. I want you to do it with the finger first. If you have a problem, I want you to ask myself, Denise, or someone. The retroreflective grid, you set this up to your face, and you look towards the sun, and you're going to see a little round ball of light. And if you move that little round ball of light right onto Denise, a little lower, all right. This is not hard. Some of you, now this seems real easy. You've done this, you put it on Denise. But now the chopper's coming from over here. What you've got to do is be able to work this like this. See, it's still on my fingers for this side over here. I lost my mirror. See how you got to be able to turn with this and still keep it on your finger. and this is what you have to be able to do. Okay, everybody, pass the mirror. Once you feel comfortable, or once I've seen you do it, step out here and do it, so we can all watch everybody do it.
I already did it.
Here's the mirror. Site where you are, have the mirror between your eye and the finger. I mean, you can do it like this, but then you're not aiming very well. So once you get this on your fingers and you start getting your flash, move it into a direct line. I assumed you would know that, but I was just told that you may not. So let's make that happen. Thank you, Paul. One thing I left out on the whistle class, I want to address that very quickly before we move on to another thing. This is something I actually learned from my father when I was just a kid, and I was reminded of it by this gentleman down here. Piece of grass.
Pig whistle.
Everyone done this?
No.
It's a whistle.
Put it between your fingers, and I'm not sure I can do this anymore because I got old fingers. If not, I'm going to have him come up and do it.
Old fingers?
You'll notice when you put your thumbs together, there's like a little round hole there. What you're going to try to do is stretch this between that hole.
Make like a reed.
Jesus, I'm retarded.
Hey, great.
Don't think I'm going to do it twice. It's a whistle. You blow it three times, it's better than not blowing anything. That was a good point, thank
it's
you.
It's also good for calling in coyote.
Yes, it is. That's it. If you're hungry, you want to eat, or if you have young children, you want to eliminate, call in the coyotes. Everyone understand the basic concept of a signal whistle. We've looked at some of the best out there. What people forget is anything shiny can be used as a signal whistle. As with everything I teach is improvise, adapt, overcome. It's the old Marine Corps way. We all do this. A lot of women carry compacts. How many people in this room have a signal mirror or a mirrored compass? I know there's a few because we sold some. There's a signal mirror. It may not have the sighting hole. Something is better than nothing. The advantage of this two fingers is even though you don't have the hole, you can still see whatever you're using, the circle from a compact mirror, a square from your compass. You can still set that over both fingers to where you know you're signaling true for the purposes of aiming. If you broke down in a vehicle, how many, this is a newer crowd, how many here have CDs in the vehicle?
Yeah.
Instant signal mirror, people. Mm. Even have the hole in it. Great. Ooh, look at the shiny.
Look at that.
This thing works great. This is better than my Joe Cocker one.
Who?
Nice. Signal mirror. I saw a situation where they took a bunch of these. They were up on basically a hill like this, and they made a signal tree. They took a whole bunch. This is a few years ago when they used to carry these when they hiked. They had the Walkman on them or whatever it was. And they just dangled these off a tree, and the wind blew them around like this. And when you looked up, there was all this flashing. And they went up to see what it was, and they had made a signal tree. All using CDs. There's a thing you can buy in the automotive store called replacement mirror. So if you break the side mirror on your vehicle, your rear view mirror, something like that, you can buy this stuff and cut it down. And it's got self-stickum on the back. Looks sort of like this. This still has the plastic on it. Very shiny stuff. Very bendable. So what you can do with that, with just a pair of scissors, is cut a piece off it. Poke a hole in it. Very thin, very shiny. Once leave the protective plastic on it until you need it. As you just learned, we did this class. I had two mirrors on there. I had forgotten to take the plastic off. People are going, this retroreflective grid don't work. And I peeled the plastic off and it worked fine. That's the protective glass because this is plastic. But you can see the thinness of this. This could go in any kit. I've had one like this for years in my wallet. And when it gets a little beat up, I just cut off another piece. I poke a hole through it with a little punch. I got a leather punch. I got a lot of leather punches. I just punch a hole through the center, and I make it the same size as a credit card. Is it an excellent, great, wonderful signal mirror? No. Is it better than no signal mirror? Of course it is. Anything's better than nothing. Broke down the vehicle, I'd be ripping the mirror off my rear view mirror or the one outside the car to get me a mirror to be able to signal. You find an old soda can, polish the bottom. A lot of people build survival pins, polish the inside of the lid. so you can use that for a signal mirror. There's a lot of things you can use. Just because you don't have a real signal mirror with you doesn't mean you don't have something you can signal with. Okay. Ground air signals. Ground air signals are signals that you put on the ground and you send up to the air. There's a lot of ways to do this. It's only your imagination that's going to limit you. One of the things you have to remember is size. Size is, what is the optimal size to see from the air? And that's 3 foot wide by 18 foot long. Damn, I've known this all my life. 18 foot long. I'm right. I surprise myself sometimes. So if you're going to make an X, which is my recommendation, each leg of that X should be 18 feet long and 3 feet wide. How do we do it? Sticks, rocks. What I like to do is do it in the snow. Because one of the things you really have to remember on these ground air signals is shadows help you, people. They really help you. Shadows will make your thing look larger. If you make an X, it's simple. Less labor intensive. If you make an SOS or anything like this, you're putting yourself a lot more work. An X tells you, here I am, come get me. Okay? I do them in the snow, and you can just walk them out. Just walk yourself in the snow. Now, immediately, once you get the big X in the snow, you already have the shadow effect. But now you can fill that in with pine boughs, a charcoal from your fire. One of the things I carry, and we'll mention here for water, is these. Dye markers. Dye markers are used when you're boating and stuff. You open them up and you pour this in the water and it gives you this huge green circle. I carry these in my winter kit. And when I have to walk out an X, there's one in my new book coming out that we made and we show from the air. And what I did is I sprinkled this in and it just turns it all orangey green. So it really adds contrast to your signal. Hand signals. Hand signals. There's, you look at your Air Force manuals, signaling manuals, there's tons of signals out there. To me, you only need one. One hand signal, and that's come get me. I need help. This means I need help. Both hands in the air. So many people, you see them on the movies, the chopper's coming in. Over here.
Hello.
Okay. One hand means I'm okay, go away. So what I tell people, it's easy to remember, don't wave at the rescuers. Don't wave. Always two hands. That's it. Two hands. Laser markers, strobes. There's a lot of different things. We don't have time to get into all these little things. We can discuss them if you need. There's things out there called flares. Used a lot on the water. This one here, you pop it out, there's a chain. Shoots the flare up in the air. Problem with flares, short-lived. Don't shoot them until you know the guy is right there.
And they're also short shelf life.
Short shelf life. Hard to ship. These are strobes. One has a flashlight on one end, one doesn't. You can hook these to you when you fall in the water. These things will strobe 3 miles up in the air. Quack, quack, quack. If you're in like a raft, something like this is a real handy item. I have one of this one here. And my PFD, there's a pocket right at the top. This slides in it, and I have it so I can just pop it out and these float. Okay, laser flares. Most people haven't discussed laser flares. I've been carrying them for years. This is a laser flare. What this does is give you a long light. People think of lasers as a point. A pointed laser is illegal to use for signaling. Okay, this is a laser flare made for signaling. See this? Little line on this thing here.
Oh yeah.
Let's see if I can get it. See it up here?
Oh yeah.
This line, it doesn't look very big. As it goes out, it grows. At 3 miles, this is 3,000 feet wide.
Wow.
At night, this is awesome. Anyone, if I play with these at night, come with me. I have a bunch. We'll go out and we'll play with these.
And what is it called?
Laser flare.
Yeah, take it in the back of the classroom. These things are absolute dynamite. You can have them this way, you can have them this way. I've actually, yeah, go back even further.
At 1,000 feet, you said it's...
You guys see it's on a filler.
there it is.
See how it's already increased? Alan's only moved back a few feet. These are the greatest things since canned beer, people. This is the only company that makes a great land laser, it's called. We happen to be one of their dealers. Just
why is laser pens legal for signaling?
Because it's a point laser, and they don't want you pointing it at something. The reason why a point laser isn't any good for signaling is it's a point. And it doesn't grow, it's just a point. With this thing, as it goes out, there's this fan. And what you do once you get it out there, you just do like you would a signal mirror. Yeah, these things are fun to play with on signs that are made from retro-reflective material. You go like this with them, and it's like you're painting it red. The whole thing will be red.
And you said it's about 3,000 feet wide?
Yeah, and it goes even further as it goes out. When you go 6 miles, it's 6 hours. Up to 20 miles at night, 1 to 3 during the day. You can see this, 1 to 3 miles during the day. At 8 miles, it's 3,000 feet wide. At 16 miles, it's 6,000 feet wide.
Oh. This, what about when you shoot it in the air? How wide does it get then?
That's what we're talking about. No matter what direction, okay. It's the further out it goes. Okay, we've run out of time here. What I want to get into smoke, generating smoke. We talked about that earlier. There's various ways to do smoke generators. One, you can just knock a log down on the ground and have a small fire ready to go there and throw pine boughs on it. Coniferous trees are great for this white smoke. Okay, another way you can do it is, I don't know if they covered this in the fire class, one of the fire lays we show is a log cabin fire lay. If you don't know what a log cabin fire lay is, then we're kind of lost at the moment. But the idea of that, it allows a lot of air to come into it, and you throw your pine boughs on it. One of my favorite is built right back here. If everyone will turn around, we want to show this before we end the class. This is called a tripod smoke generator. What you do is you build a tripod, people, like you're going for anything else in fire to cook over a fire. Inside of this tripod, you're going to build a high little platform to put your fire starting material on. So one of the reasons why I really like this is if it's one that you have to start when you hear the rescue starting, these, I hope, hopefully will show, go up very quickly. What you do, once you get the tripod, you put your tinder in here, you get your fire starting materials going, and then you start putting your boughs over top of this thing and just hang them. When you do this tripod, don't make it a tight tripod. Leave pieces sticking up for you to be able to hang this stuff on. I'm like almost done here, so let's fire this up.
Lighter.
Lighter. Got a hand drill. Anybody got a hand drill?
Road flares?
Lighter, give me 10 minutes.
I say it in all my classes, only two sticks I want to be rubbing in emergency situation are road flares.
What if you're not in an emergency?
You got cameras, you may want to be able to get the smoke going off the sink. Once, the advantage of this is the Venturi effect. That's why I like this. You notice how this is all open at the bottom? Once this fire gets going, it's going to be sucking oxygen, and it's going to suck it right up through this, causing the fire to immediately get up into the coniferous boughs, whatever you use. Here we have cedar, and we have spruce, and it causes the smoke to go right up. Well, the chopper left, Alan.
Alan, you want a Zippo?
It's just one.
Didn't
we have three of these?
It's just
that
one
in here.
Yeah.
Someone gave us poor tinder.
Quick, somebody grab tinder.
Somebody grab tinder.
Is that tinder laying over there?
Can't tinder.
Drink it, baby. Okay, now we're starting to get that dark smoke. Keep in mind, we got heavy wind here. What did I tell you about wind? Look where the smoke's going. But on a calm day, this is going to go straight up like a funnel.
You don't want any more of this.
Okay, now it's going. I hear it. You may want to get away there, Paul.
Get a blow!
Yeah, we told to do this when it's really windy.
Hey, I You all may want to get to this side of the wind, people. That would be my suggestion. Upwind move.
Get over here.
All right, this is good shot here. Does everyone get the concept here? This right now is sucked in the air up to the bottom, which is causing the smoke to go up like this.
Wow! Right. Son of a bitch!
All right, now we have a smoke generator.
That's insane. Time to move.
I need to be impressed eventually. There's hundreds of things more I can tell you about signaling, but they gave me 1 hour. Because originally this was supposed to be taught by Paul.
Yeah.